People of God, we have come from our everyday lives, from our errands and chores, our projects and plans, our people and pastimes, to create space for God in our midst. Here we bring every bit of ourselves and our lives into the presence of our Creator. Welcome to worship with One United Church of Christ. Thank you for making time in your week to join us in this time of turning toward God and being strengthened and renewed for the living of these days. A bulletin that accompanies today's service can be found in the weekly church email that was sent out on Thursday and shared to Facebook. We encourage you to download that, follow along with the service, and look at the announcements and the prayer list in the back. Highlighting some of those, we are working toward reopening to in-person indoor weekly worship starting Sunday, July 4th. Throughout the summer, we're going to be alternating indoor-outdoor services because we really like worshiping outdoors, and it also gives an alternative for those who are not yet comfortable being in the sanctuary to do so. So for the month of June, our last outdoor worship service will be June 27th. Then in July, July 4th, we'll be right here in this space. It'll be wonderful to be with people here once again. Then Sunday, July 11th, we'll be out in the parking lot and keep alternating throughout the summer. Regardless of whether we're indoors or outdoors, worship will be at 9:30. Another couple of reminders, we're continuing to look for a treasurer. If you know somebody who would be interested in that position, please contact the church office. The worship committee is meeting this coming Wednesday night at 6:30 p.m. right here in the sanctuary. The hearts that you continue to see around us are in memory of the over 27,500 people in Pennsylvania who have died from COVID-19. They are a continued call to prayer. We're not out of the pandemic yet. And so friends, if you can be vaccinated and haven't, I would highly encourage you to do so to help those who cannot be vaccinated. If you have things that you can do to protect other people, please keep doing them. And also please keep everybody's feelings and thoughts about where we are in this pandemic held with a lot of grace. It's been a rough season for all of us, and we continue to show love and support and prayer for one another. The hearts ask us to do all this. Also, happy Father's Day today to all the fathers, stepfathers, grandfathers, uncles, and people who have been like fathers to us. As we celebrate today, we also remember and share lots of love and prayers with those who struggle with Father's Day. Whatever this day may mean to you, we are with you in both the sadness and the celebration, holding you in the strength of God's love. Finally, thank you for all your support of this ministry. Thank you for the ways that you send in your financial supports. Thank you for the ways that you show up in presence. Thank you for being God's people in these days. So friends in Christ, as we move more deeply into this time of worship, we need to keep in mind that today's service is going to look and sound a little bit different. Our director of music, Jeff Miller, is out this week on a well-deserved week of vacation. And we welcome our guest musician, the Dr. William Delaplane Powell III, whose bio is in the bulletin. I'm not going to go through it because it's really, really, really long, but he is my big brother. And so he has graciously offered music for today's service. It was recorded in a different location, so things are going to look and sound a little bit different. So through the music, we invite you to just be still, be in the presence of God. During the hymn, sing, and during the pieces of special music, just pray and listen and enjoy. And so friends in Christ, we take a deep breath and center ourselves on God who is with us in worship now. Thank you. of God, in this time and place, we are invited to seek deeper relationship with God. We don't leave our lives behind when we start this video. We carry with us our worries and our stresses and our gladness and our hopes. We bring all that we are to this time, and it is enough. Here we are accepted in love that understands all. Here we are transformed by love that redeems all. Through our worship now, may we allow ourselves to dwell in the joy of God's searching, transforming love. Today is no exception. As we have come to seek you here, we pray you would reveal yourself to us. We ask to be awakened to the joy you have woven into creation, to shake off the weariness we carry, and to encounter your renewal. By sharing this time together, move us closer to realizing the alternate community you intend to build among all who follow you. Connect us more deeply, we pray, to all who seek you and seek to live by the love with which you fashion the world. Amen. Families, we love them, and yet the messiness of being a family member can affect us for a lifetime in ways both blessing and curse. God knows the complexity of families and has some things to say about relating to our relatives. As we continue exploring our Ten Commandments series and our Words of Stone, Hearts of Flesh series, we look at the fifth commandment that we'll hear in a moment. Yet our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ also had a few things to say about families. I invite you to listen for how both the words from Exodus and the words from Matthew that are Jesus's words are similar and also what's different. And then wonder with me, how does God desire that we connect with our families? Listen for God's words first in the book of Exodus and then in the Gospel of Matthew.
Today's scripture reading is Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. Honor your father and your mother so that your life will be long on the fertile land that the Lord your God is giving you.
A reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 12, verses 46 through 50. While Jesus was speaking to the crowds, his mother and brothers stood outside trying to speak with him. Someone said to him, "Look, your mother and brothers are outside wanting to speak with you." Jesus replied, "Who is my mother? Who are my brothers?" He stretched out his hand toward his disciples and said, "Look, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of my Father, who is in heaven, is my brother, sister, and mother."
Will you join me in prayer? Holy God, in the words that you have spoken long ago, in the words that I speak today, in the words that come to our minds and our hearts in this time, we pray that your Spirit would lead us and guide us. Reveal to us how you would want us to be as people, as families, as communities, and as your people on this world. Holy God, we pray that you would speak to us, for us, your servants, are listening. Amen. Families are complicated. We love them, we hate them, we are indifferent to them. Yet we are all part of a family group. Systems that we are born into, we create, or we name in terms of other than biology or genetics or marriage. Families define us and help us figure out who we are. They support us and are there for us no matter what. Families can also limit us and tell us who we cannot become. They can ostracize us and abuse us. Families are one of the more complicated topics to preach on because the Christian church tends to celebrate families. If we didn't, we wouldn't have such emphasis these days on biblical family values and focus on the family. Yet at the same time, some preachers and congregations like this one recognize the complexity of being connected in families. Hopefully our two scripture readings today are already giving you a sense that the Bible truly recognizes the complexity of families too. Perhaps one of the first passages of scripture that comes to mind when we think about what does the Bible have to say about families is the fifth commandment. Honor your father and mother so that your life will be long on the fertile land that the Lord your God is giving you. Sometimes we stop reading the Bible there and think honoring our parents and children respectfully obedient to their parents is exactly how families should operate. Reading more of the Bible, though, we quickly realize that is not the case. The families we meet in the Bible are just as complicated, dysfunctional, abusive, and wonderful as families today. We get a hint of this wider vision of families from the story about Jesus and his family that we heard in Matthew 12. Jesus' family of origin doesn't really appear much in the Gospels, and when they do, they are almost tangential to the stories in which they do appear. During Matthew 12, Jesus is engaged in a particularly contentious stint of teaching and healing and has gotten into some rather intense conflict with the Pharisees. In the midst of his working, his mother and brothers show up to one of Jesus' gigs. The crowd was so great that they couldn't get up close to talk to him, they couldn't see him, and so they sent word that they wanted to speak with Jesus. Upon hearing this message from a messenger, Jesus asks, "Who is my mother? Who are my brothers?" Gesticulating toward his disciples, he calls them his mother and his brothers, redefining family as anyone who does the will of God. Matthew 12 is a curious story. To our modern ears, it sounds like Jesus is dismissing his family of origin. In Mark's version of this story, Jesus' mother and siblings have shown up to bring Jesus home because he seems to be bringing shame upon his family, with some of their neighbors whispering that Jesus is demon-possessed. This story from Matthew 12 about Jesus redefining family is beautiful because it catches the complexity of family, the reality of family, and God's intention for families. While Jesus' own biological family doesn't receive much mention in the Gospels, the bits we do have suggest that they struggled with his ministry. By engaging in work so completely against the status quo and the tradition of his society, Jesus likely brought shame to his family in a culture where familial honor and shame were of utmost importance. After all, a crucified family member was nothing to brag about. Much like today, if we had a relative who had been on death row and was publicly executed by the state, we wouldn't likely be proud of that relative either. Jesus must have been a complicated person to have in one's family tree. And yet, some of his family members were strong supporters of his ministry. His mother was at the cross. His brother James is thought to be the author of our biblical book of James. Family is complicated. And that was true for Jesus just as much as any of us, as he was fully human. The incarnation of God in Jesus means that God understands the complexity of family and the reality of family. Sometimes families are wonderful. Sometimes they're crap. God's intention for families is not that children are subordinate to their parents or that we go around unthinkingly honoring our elders, as the fifth commandment has been popularly interpreted to suggest. God's intention for families is different, as Jesus vividly illustrates in Matthew 12. God's intention for families is to pass on the faith, the good news of God's love from generation to generation. Reading the fifth commandment more deeply, this is actually what the honor your father and mother points to. The more we look at the Ten Commandments, the more amazing and beautiful they are. The first couple commandments point to how we are to be in relationship with God. And with the fifth commandment, we transition to what God has to say about how we are to be in relationship with one another. God begins these commandments about relating to one another with some words about our families. Of the foremost concern of our Creator is addressing the problematic relationships between one generation and the next. That's really what the fifth commandment gets at, that we honor our elders and treat them with appropriate seriousness, as the Hebrew word for honor points to. The fifth commandment doesn't mean that we are to be subservient to our parents or generation before us. Now, going a step deeper, why would God be concerned that we treat our parents with appropriate seriousness? The fifth commandment answers that question in the second half of it that we tend to overlook. We are to treat our parents with appropriate seriousness so that we may live long in the land God provides. That land God provides represents the covenant God was making right then and there with the people of Israel in Exodus 20. But for us, many thousands of years later, the second part of the fifth commandment refers more to treating our parents with appropriate seriousness so that we develop and maintain relationships with the Lord our God and then pass the knowledge, the relationship, the teachings, the goodness of God to the next generation after us. The concern of the fifth commandment isn't to establish the nuclear family as God's desired way to organize society. Rather, the concern is to establish the family as a means of passing the faith on, the means that we know God's stories of wonder, power, and love, the means by which relationship and connection with God are shared. Really then, the point of the fifth commandment is to honor our parents to ensure the transmission of faith from one generation to the next. If the point of the fifth commandment is to address relationships between generations with serious implications for faith, then that raises some more questions. What if we have a different faith or different faith beliefs than our parents? Or what if our parents have been really lousy parents? That's where the story from Matthew 12 comes in. For Christians, the nuclear family is not the to-be-all and end-all of society. Rather than focusing on the family, we should be focusing on the faith community. Jesus redefines family as anyone who does the will of God. Anyone who does God's will is our relative, our parents, our brothers, our sisters. Which then means the commandment to honor our parents is more than honoring our parents by birth or adoption. Honoring our parents means honoring, treating with appropriate seriousness, all of those who have passed their faith down to us. Such people might be our biological or adoptive parents and grandparents. Those that we honor can be our Sunday school teachers, pastors, lay leaders, fellow congregants, friends, members of congregations we've attended. For me, those people who have most directly impacted my faith are somehow represented in worship today. All of the participants in today's service are members of my family because, hey, if you're putting together a service on the fifth commandment that explicitly addresses familial relationships, makes sense to have your family lead worship with you, right? My family members, like my mother, my brother, my daughter, have had important roles in helping me grow closer to God. But some of the people who have impacted my faith profoundly are deceased, or are a community of people larger than any single individual. Yet they are still represented somehow today. All of the music in this service was recorded at my home church, Glade United Church of Christ in Walkersville, Maryland, and many thanks to Glade for allowing us to record there. My brother's also the director of music there. That group of people, Glade UCC, that congregation taught me the reality of Jesus' words, that a group of disciples can become one's family. The people of Glade were my first role models in faith, especially as they taught me the Bible stories. They showed me how to put faith into action through mission and service. They inspired my practice of faith, and they have been incredibly supportive of my call to ministry even to this day. Also, the piano that you heard my brother play in worship today was given to Glade in memory of my grandmother, who gave me the gift of a home church and shared her faith with me deeply. The people you see in today's service and the ones represented in other ways are those that I need to treat with appropriate seriousness in addition to all of you. This community of faith has taught me so much about being a pastor, about being a disciple, and by virtue of us all trying to do the will of God together, you are my family. I'm curious though, who do you consider as your family in faith? Would your parents be among those you are called to honor? Your grandparents, siblings, friends from church, pastors you've had over the years, soul friends who help you be stronger followers of Jesus? Whoever they are, I hope this week that you can take some time to give thanks for them. If they are still in the land of the living, drop them a note, a text, an email, a phone call, and let them know what they mean to you and have meant in your faith journey. If those people are with God, spend some time in prayer giving thanks to them, and find a way to honor their legacy in this world, whether through sharing stories about them with someone or what they taught you about faith with someone, donating to a worthwhile organization in their memory, or doing something to better the world and brighten someone's day because of their impact on your life. My friends in Christ, my family in Christ, really, none of us can do this following Jesus thing alone or unsupported. We need to focus on the faith community. We need the community of faith to support each other as healthy families do. We need one another to encourage each other, even to challenge and push each other to be our best, healthiest selves as good families do. In the moments when we drive each other bonkers, as all families do, we need to remind each other of God's grace and goodness that shines through all of the ways we love each other and all of the ways we get on each other's nerves. Most of all, we need a group of disciples to help us learn how to be Jesus' followers, to tell us and remind us of the stories of God's wonders, power, and love, to show us why Jesus and the Christian faith still matter today, and to keep telling us what is so beautiful, so powerful, and so good about a communal faith. May we give thanks this week for such people and communities who help us grow in discipleship and faith. And may we have the grace to be such people and communities that we help others grow closer to God and deeper in faith. May it be so in all of your lives and mine, today and in the days ahead. Amen. Will you join me in prayer? Holy God, life giver of us all, you have poured out your love into all that you have created. You care for us with a love and a provision that is everlasting. Today we pray for your entire human family. We especially pray this weekend for those caught in systems of oppression and evil, whether through violence, slavery, human trafficking, or abuse. This weekend, as we remember and celebrate Juneteenth, we pray, O God, your liberation may be made real among all people. Help us not to love power or privilege so much that we cling to it more than we do our love of neighbor. Use us, we pray, to be agents of your salvation in both word and in action. Holy One, we remember today concerns closer to home. We lift up to you all who are ill and those who care for them. We pray for those we've named as a community on our prayer list, especially Judy and Bob Herzog and Linda S. Gracious God, we ask you to sustain them and sustain us through so much. And you do. You unfailingly do. You are our rock, our strength, and our hope. And we thank you for your steadfast provision. You give to us in so many ways, Holy One, for you are our good parent, whom we have known in various ways, including as our Father in heaven. On this day, this week, we give thanks to you for our earthly fathers and for all who have nurtured us in faith and in life. Through the best fathers, we see a glimpse of your eternal love lived out. Today, we pray for all fathers. We give thanks for those who seek to love their partners, nurture their children, support their families, and live their faith. We pray for grace in the times when balancing the many demands of life fails. Holy One, we also pray for those who lacked a good model of fatherhood, those who raise themselves, those who seek to do better with their own children. We pray for all those who know their imperfections, yet each day keep trying to do their best to support their children, nurturing and teaching them. We pray for all who wish to be fathers, but who never had the chance. We pray for all of us who have lost fathers and fathers who have lost children. We pray for us all, O Lord, and the many emotions we carry on this day: joy, disappointment, sadness, confusion, longing, and so much more. For all that we carry into this day, we pray in your holy name. For all that we have named aloud and all that yet remains unnamed in our hearts, we raise to your care, your concern, and your healing. Trusting in your Holy Spirit and in the love demonstrated through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, we ask this in his name and with his words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
not to faint. Do not pray for easy lives. Pray to be stronger, women and men. Do not pray for tasks equal to your powers, but for power equal to your tasks. Then the doing of your work and the living of your lives will be no miracle, for you will be the miracle. And every day you will wonder at the richness of life which has come to you by the grace of God. And may that same grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the hope of the Holy Spirit go with us today and always. Amen.